Three American troops killed and dozens more injured following a drone attack on U.S. forces stationed in Jordan. This marks the first time U.S. troops were killed in the area since the Israel-Hamas war broke out in October. U.S. President Joe Biden blaming Iran-backed militant groups, vowing to hold them responsible.
I want to point out that we had a tough day last night in the Middle East. We lost three brave souls in attacking one of our bases.
Yes.
And I'd ask you for a moment of silence for all three of those fallen soldiers.
Jeez.
And we shall respond. God bless you all. Thank you for allowing me to be here.
On X, U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin said he's outraged and deeply saddened by the deaths of the American soldiers. An analyst believes the deaths of three U.S. service members due to in Jordan could lead to a further escalation of tensions in the Middle East. Laura James of Oxford Analytica says the U.S. will have to respond even more strongly than it has to previous attacks that will possibly kill top Iraqi and Iranian militia leaders.
This is a very important escalatory step. It's in some ways, it's what we've been worrying about for the past several weeks, and to some extent for the last couple of months, in that US casualties was always seen as a red line. US deaths in all of these attacks that we've seen on various US interests, US bases, minor injuries, people targeted who weren't actually US citizens. This is the tipping point. So three US soldiers' deaths is important. It's not necessarily a tipping point into uncontrolled escalation between the United States and Iran, but it's another very dangerous step because, as I say, the US will have to respond even more strongly than it's done to previous attacks. That means possibly killing some very, very senior Iraqi militia leaders, possibly some senior Iranians.
Palestine's prime minister urges countries which paused their funds to the UN Agency for Palestinian Refugees to reverse their decision. On Sunday, UN officials implored countries to reconsider a pause in funding, vowing to punish anyone involved in the attack of Israel on Hamas. On Israel. The UN also warned aid for some 2 million people in Gaza was at stake.
The countries that have announced this suspension, their aid amounts to 70% of the annual budget of the United Nations Relief and Work Agency. This measure is extremely dangerous, and it is our hope that it will be reversed. The suspension of aid is in line with the Israeli plans for the forced evacuation of our people from Gaza into Egypt. The suspension of aid comes at the most difficult times, at a time when the International Court of Justice has called for an immediate supply and increased supplies and international aid into Gaza. UNRWA provide aid for 1.7 million Palestinians in Gaza.
At least nine countries, including top donors, the U.S. and Germany, have paused its aid for the agency amid allegations by Israel that a dozen on the staff in Gaza were involved in the October 7 rampage. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, DJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making headlines in the North American region. We begin with Canada, where they're announcing that it will reduce the number of international students that will be accepted in the country by 35% in the next 2 years.
This year, only about 360,000 of international students' permits will be issued, representing a 35% decrease from 2023.
It is the latest in a series of measures to improve program integrity and set international students up for the success in order to maintain a sustainable level of temporary residence in Canada as well.
Immigration authorities are also introducing caps for each province and territory. Officials say the limit will be weighted by population and will result in significant decreases in provinces where the international student population has seen the most growth. The caps will not impact current study permit holders or study permit renewals and do not include those pursuing master's and doctoral degrees.
I think that the government has to do what they have to do with regards to the circumstances that they are currently encountering. And while it is harsh, I think some of the reasons why they are doing it is warranted, because I've heard a lot of stories, I've seen a lot of articles talking about the way applicants have tried to falsify information or use loopholes, and I think the government is just simply trying to respond to that.
In sports, Pinoy pride is back on the golf course as the PGA Tour finally has its first full-blooded Filipino and first Philippine-born golfer.
Riku Ohoy won the 2023 Visit Knoxville Open and finished in the top five of the Corn Ferry Tour as a stats leader in many categories. With that success last year, Ohoy earned his PGA Tour card for 2024, making history as the only player to represent the Philippines in the top pro golf league in the world. Ohoy wrapped up the third tournament of his young career in Torrey Pines in San Diego at the Farmers Insurance Open. Though he has yet to make a cut in his first three starts, Ohoy is relishing the chance to be among the world's best.
You see how it is, the atmosphere, it's pretty cool being around all these people. And, it's so different from Corn Ferry or anything else.
The 28-year-old rookie and USC alumnus admitted he was a bit surprised to see the crowd of Filipino fans in Torrey Pines following him and cheering him on.
It's kind of cool to see, represent them and represent all you guys. I think it's a proud country.
And finally, we get to know the Filipino cast members of a new six-part limited series that looks into the lives of a tight-knit group of expats in Hong Kong and their domestic help.
Don't you ever miss it? Home?
Prime Video's highly anticipated show, Expats, premiered its first two episodes Thursday night, with Nicole Kidman leading the multicultural cast, including Filipino actresses Ruby Ruiz and Abilene Pardenilla, who play domestic workers hired by expats in Hong Kong.
I didn't even realize in the beginning how humongous this project is. And working with Nicole Kidman, one of the most memorable, one of the most unforgettable.
Pardenilla, who plays Puri, is an actual overseas Filipino worker who earns a living as a singer in Hong Kong.
Mga pangalan na to, pero hindi mo mapipil na hindi ka talaga ma-intimidate kasi napaka-humble nila, napaka-accommodating. Alam, nag-a-adjust din sila kasi lalo na sa akin, alam nila na first time ko mag-act.
Meanwhile, one of Kidman's TV sons, Philip Wu, is played by Bori Del Rosario, Filipino-Puerto Rican-American actor.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Check out TFC News on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to the studio.